So tonight we're going to be hearing from Luke Wagner from Mozilla. He's going to be talking to us about WebAssembly. The title of the talk is a new compiler target for the web. What that means, well, he'll tell you. I'd like to say how much we appreciate Bloomberg for sponsoring us with this space, and thank you to everyone for coming on out. We're here for you. If you weren't coming, we couldn't do this, and so we appreciate your showing up and participating. Tonight, before we get started, we have our usual requests. First is silence your cell phones, devices, anything. Second is don't eat snacks and noisy wrappers during the presentation. Do whatever you can to avoid it. It's incredibly disruptive. Not so bad in this location, but I'm still saying it a year later. Please use the mics for questions. Actually, I didn't ask you this. Luke, would you prefer for questions to be during, after, or sort of at spaced intervals? Okay. Great. So we'll leave the mics on, and if you have questions, please come up to the mic. Please don't just raise your hand. That way, people who look at the recording later might not be able to know what you asked, and the answer may not mean as much. That's mainly why we asked for this, so please help out with that. Our next meeting date is being worked on. It's going to be early June, but we're just working on the exact dates right now, so please look at the meetup page. That should be up shortly. I'd like to thank our space sponsor again, Bloomberg, and acknowledge our other sponsors, past and present, IBM, Canonical, Brandor, Google, O'Reilly Media, and actually, been meaning to add this. Thank you very much to Prentice Hall for the books. Should be Prentice Hall, or should be Pearson is probably right. Okay, Pearson for the books also. Many of our giveaway books are from them, and I think we've neglected to put them here, so my bad. In addition, NYLUG would not be able to function without our many volunteers who've contributed greatly over the years. You tend to meet them up at the table, whatever, say hi to them as well. Please introduce yourself. We're here for you. So announcements for the workshops, there was one yesterday, right? They are on the meetup page. Please talk to Rob or David or Greg if you have any questions about them. They're happening at City College at 138th in Amsterdam. The next workshop will be, do you know the day of the next one offhand? Sorry, I neglected to look that up today. I'm full of little things here. So yeah, we had one yesterday. The next one will probably be in June then, right? It's usually every 2 weeks, so maybe one more. Okay, check the meetup page. The workshops are where you get to just sit down and have a space to work on the thing you want to, and maybe have some other people around who you can ping questions off of. In case you missed it, you can grab a Linux distro DVD from the back over there. They're on the windowsill. Grab one that interests you. They are free to take with you for you to try. After the presentation, we will be heading to Jake's Saloon at 206 West 23rd Street. That is just on 23rd Street and then across 7th Avenue on the downtown side of the street. Just a couple of blocks. It's not as long as it seems when you're walking there. Long blocks, though. Does anyone in the audience have any announcements, any events coming up that they'd like to mention, anything like that? All right, well, if you do in the future, feel free to bring them up. You can have the floor for a moment. And note that at the end of the presentation, there will be trivia questions asked by Luke with material from the presentation. We only have four books, though, so pick your four favorites, okay? The prizes will be one of the four, your choice of one of the four books, so if you're interested, please pay attention and sit tight till the end, and those questions will be asked, and the game will be afoot. I do that at the end. So anyway, thank you very much for sitting through all of that, welcome to Luke Wagner with his talk, WebAssembly, a new compiler target for the web. Please welcome Luke.
All right. Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for having me. If you have a question, raise your hand. I don't see it. Feel free to just call out. If you happen to have questions anytime. So I'm going to be talking about WebAssembly. What's that?
Please come up to the mic.
Oh, it's even better.
Yeah, just so that it makes it into the video.
Great. Awesome. if you want to get these slides, they're on this site. All right, so first a little about me. I'm an engineer at Mozilla. I've been working there for just now 7 years, both on the JavaScript engine and more recently on the research team. Pretty much the whole time, though, I've been working on SpiderMonkey, which is the name of the Firefox JavaScript engine. And I've worked on a number of projects. So the whole code base is named SpiderMonkey, but all of our projects tend to have monkey in the name also. So TraceMonkey and JaegerMonkey are early attempts at JITs. IronMonkey are current beefy profiling, speculative, type-specializing JIT that's in Firefox now. ODEMonkey are asm.js optimizations, which I'll be talking about a little bit later. And BalderMonkey are upcoming WebAssembly support. also a co-chair of the WebAssembly WC community group. So, outline for the talk, gonna talk about, well, what is WebAssembly? Then give a little tour of WebAssembly, show some concrete examples, show a little demo. Then say, what do APIs mean for WebAssembly? Talk about beyond compiling C++, other languages, and we might want to compile to WebAssembly in the future, and then just answer some frequently asked questions. So first, in one slide, what is WebAssembly? It's a one-slide definition. So it's a new standard. This is not a plugin. This is something to be implemented in browsers. And it's being developed in a W3 community group with official membership from Apple, Google, Microsoft, and Mozilla, engineers participating for all four companies, and a whole bunch of other great companies, too, looking at making sure it'll run well on their architectures or on their devices. And it defines two things, a binary format, which goes over the wire to the browser, and a text format, which is what you see. And you know, delving into this, the binary format, we want it to be compact. We want to reduce the size over the wire compared to JavaScript. Needs to be just as portable as JavaScript, though. We want it to run the same on different devices, different browsers. Fast to load is kind of the whole point of having a binary format. We want to be able to, you know, represent variables with indices and integers instead of names and hash tables. And needs to, of course, run safely. This is the web. And at predictably near native speed. You should be able to get good performance without being a JavaScript VM engineer. As for the text format, it's a one-to-one text format, which means you can go back and forth between the binary and the text format. If you get a binary over the wire, you can just dump it to text, add a printf, go right back to binary, load it up. So it's actually a little better than native assembly in some ways because, well, we'll talk a bit about that later, but you know, native assembly code will have like absolute offsets that if you add some code, you've broken the whole thing, and WebAssembly doesn't have that. So one-to-one text format, it is rendered by developer tools. So anywhere in your developer tools you would see JavaScript now, you will see this text format. It is rendered on demand, even though what came over the wire was the binary. And view source is a very important aspect of the web, very important thing for Mozilla, and so that's what we're trying to support here.
Bob Gesalter, what about signing or sealing?
Sorry, what?
Signing or sealing downloads?
Oh.
So your local hotel does not insert malware?
Oh yeah, well, good question. I think that for that we're just basically wholly relying on the existing web infrastructure. So you know, TLS, certs, and all that type of stuff that you know. What prevents them from serving malicious JavaScript today?
Officially, a request, add a feature to the interface to seal or check some of the contents?
Well, I'd be interested to talk more specifically about the attack vectors you're thinking about. So yeah, to talk about that more. All right, so that was the high level one slide definition. So let's talk about different ways to look at this. So four ways I'm gonna talk about. Compiler target for the web, the name of the talk. A virtual instruction set architecture, a JavaScript feature, and the evolution of asm.js, which I'll also explain what that is. So going to the first one, compiler target for the web. So critically, this is not a programming language. It's not something you write directly. It's something you compile from other languages. Now, if you have experience with other native assembly languages, you'll see WebAssembly and say, that looks a little different. And kind of a basic reason for that is that we're designing this for size and compile speed, not direct execution. We're not going to be feeding these binaries directly to any processor, at any time in the foreseeable close future. And so it changes kind of some of the aspects of WebAssembly. So one thing, whereas a normal machine code would have, you know, register architecture, you know, you read from registers, write to register, we have a stack machine. And this can just save size because in the best case, you have a byte that says do an add and you just pull your operands off the stack. You don't have to actually spend bits saying, well, where did I get it from? And so it saves bytes. And also, if you're doing a fast first pass compilation, you get some free usedef info, which is to say this, when I pop a value, it's no longer be used because I popped it. So if you're doing register allocation on the fly, it can help you do a better job. Another important thing is, you know, within the space of stack machines, there's a bunch of different ways to do them. Java made some choices that made their verification be very expensive in the worst case. I think it was like Quartic or something. And then they had something that made it better. But so what we've done is taken kind of gone to the very other end of the spectrum. Our bytecode is really constrained so that you can look at it as a post-order serialization of an AST. So if you take a syntax tree that represents, you know, or just an abstract tree that represents your program, you can think of this as just a post-order encoding where you've written the children and then you write the parents, and so you just, well, that's what a stack machine kind of is. So you can look at it either way. And the nice thing about this is validation is just type checking that AST. And that's something that's really well understood. There's a lot of course, research into, you know, type theory, and, you know, we know and have demonstrating a proof by implementation that, you know, it is really simple and fast to validate. You're just walking in one linear pass and like pushing and popping types on the stack. Yeah.
Are you familiar with the compilation techniques that JS OCaml uses? Because it sounds like you might be trying to, I mean, the intermediate bytecode is essentially, you know, a type stack machine, I'm pretty sure. And then you just go to JavaScript.
Did you say JS OCaml?
JS of OCaml.
Yeah. Oh, I saw that. Yeah. This is the converts OCaml JS to JS?
It converts OCaml bytecode, which I think is a type stack machine, to JavaScript.
Okay. Well, that's interesting. We haven't studied that one particularly. We do have some, we've actually written our reference implementation in OCaml.
Even better.
And we have some serious ML people involved, but we haven't studied that one particularly.
So you wouldn't say, like, you couldn't compare and contrast the language right now?
Not at the moment, no. But and this is to ML particular, or this particular JS of OCaml?
Specific.
Okay, yeah, I don't know enough about that to compare, but. Forth is another interesting one. I think it's dynamically typed. I mean, don't know about Forth, so we'll see later. We're super statically typed. we're meant for a compilation target. We want to know all the types, splat out fast machine code. So in addition to validation being kind of familiar from type checking world and really fast, also nice thing, and a stack machine, you know, you have to have a linear sequence of stack machine opcodes, which can be hard to follow. Like, well, what is this popping? When you constrain it to being a stack machine from an AST, we can just render the AST just as an expression language, which can allow the code to be a lot more readable when you view source it. Another important thing is, and this is actually maybe loosened in the future, is we have structure control for requirements. And the way we do is by pushing, you know, basically maintaining a stack of branch targets, and you can branch to those targets either beginning when you push on the stack of labels or at the end when you pop it and forces it to be structured. And this allows multiple nice things. One, really fast single pass construction of SSA. And second, it simplifies other sort of graph algorithms that want to assume things are reducible, control flow.
There's a confusion I have here. There are two stacks that typically go on. There's the code itself. Mm-hmm. You know, so you push and pop, that's a dynamic thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm getting confused between the bytecode, the representation, which you say is an AST thing. That's a static thing.
Mm-hmm.
Address that? You understand what I'm saying? Execution is dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
The code itself is static. Mm-hmm. And typically, so like in a PostScript engine, right, you have they have two stacks, uh-huh. Right?
Yeah.
They have the PostScript stack. There's the code stack and then there's the data stack.
Oh, okay. So really, I guess the stack machine is really a theoretical thing that defines the language. The implementation, it's going straight to like classic machine code like a C compiler would. So you can think of it really, the stack machine is basically saving us bytes on saying like, this one produces a result, this one consumes it. Plug those two SSA nodes together, you know, plug this def into this use, and then, you know, generate is just normal machine code like a C compiler might emit. So at runtime, there's really not a stack. It's kind of a conceptual stack that's executing. So I don't know if that fully answers your question. I guess, yeah, okay, great. All right, so that's compiler target. Another way to think about it is the virtual instruction set architecture. Our goal here is to be as close to the physical machine instructions as we can. So for example, WebAssembly I32 add, translates to definitely one machine instruction on x86 in ARM. The call instruction translates to one instruction on x86 in ARM. Now, it's interesting, the x86 call pushes return value on the stack. Branch and link puts the return return address in a register, and we're able to abstract over that. How in a sec. And a load turns into basically a load, but you also, and this is the key part about safety and portability, we need some sort of check to make sure that load just isn't just randomly reading anything. So how does that work? So it depends on the architecture. On 64-bit, we can do a really cool trick. We can mmap 4 whole gigabytes of virtual address space, not actual RAM, and then only the portion that you can access is you enable protection of those pages, and you can access them. But if you go out of bounds, you're definitely going to hit in this non-access zone. You're not going to hit anyone else's memory or browser memory, anything unsafe. You're going to well-defined get a fault, and we can have a fault handler that says, oh, you should throw an exception now. So on x64 and ARM64, we don't actually need a check. We just use the memory protection mechanisms built into the hardware to do it for us because we have enough address space. On 32-bit, we don't, you know, the whole address space is 4 gigabyte. We can't just take 4 gigabytes out of that. And so but they are designed to be so we can hoist the check. So one check can allow a lot of loads and stores to succeed. So we've carefully designed around it so we can make this overhead of checking as inexpensive as we can. Go more on that. Portability really does matter. Changing, you know, your browser, your version of your browser, and your device shouldn't break code. And And this is somewhat intuitive, people. If you come from like a C, C++ background, you're like, it's the developer's fault. We're allowed to do anything if they make a mistake, like, you know, get them. But we're not a language. That compilation of the ISA happens on the developer's machine. We're an ISA. We happen in the client's machine every time they run it. So we need to behave like an x86 chip. You don't expect when you add a change chips for your code to run differently. Now, of course, it might run faster, and if you had a race condition that was timing dependent, you can break. But that's more of a rare case. In general, you don't expect the behavior to change. So there's some implications of this. So one, and also initially counterintuitive, is we have a trusted call stack. So when you do a call, that needs to push a return address on a stack. We can't let the actual loads and stores of the program get at that return address, because they could just corrupt it and change the return address to be any other place. So instead, the call stack is just a separate region of memory that is not aliased by the loads and stores.
Once you start talking about a call stack, that's a runtime thing.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So there is
a. Okay. So here you, from what I heard before, what you said you could do is, I could my interpreter, right, might not use that call stack, right? It may just say, hey, I don't want to do that. I'm not gonna have a stack at all. I'm just gonna.
I have a feeling that he was just about to get to that.
Oh, okay. Are you?
We'll talk about it in a sec.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll see a lot more. So call stack is a separate region of memory from the what the region of memory accessed by loads and stores. You can trust it. The generated machine code can access it because we generate that machine code. We know exactly what's going on the stack. And basically, it's your return address and things that the register allocator spilled to the stack, kind of like a C compiler. And so the pros of this is our return, we can just do a ret on other sandboxing systems where you can't trust the return address, you have to do something when you do a ret, because you're doing an indirect jump. You have to make sure it's going to a safe place. The other, of course, critical thing is that it's deterministic. If you can randomly corrupt your return address, that return can go anywhere. If you can randomly correct spilled variables, of any variable read can produce anything, so it's a massive source of non-determinism and importability. You could just change your register allocator algorithm and break programs that maybe happen to be relying on the particular way that you'd spilled things to the stack. The cons is, of course, we can't stick alias variables. Like if you have a variable int and you take an address of it and pass the pointer out, we can't stick that on the native stack, the one that's actually used by running machine code. You have to stick that in the same linear memory that's accessed by all your loads and stores. So you maintain a second stack in the heap, which holds your alias variables, which fortunately is the uncommon case. Most of the time, these things don't need to go in the alias stack. They just go on, Well, we'll see what they become, but they become these local variables which you can't take the address of them. They're just like virtual registers. And in the future, we can have first-class stacks. Just because they're opaque doesn't mean we can do cool things like making a stack or swapping a stack to do things like coroutines or green threading. Another important thing is memory needs to be contiguous. We can't let there be little holes where other stuff can go in. Pros is we can do a lot lighter weight sandboxing than other schemes. The intention of WebAssembly is you have lots of these little modules all within a big web app. And previous schemes would need a whole process for the whole memory just because anything the process is fair game. Cons is you need to allocate contiguous memory, so there's a hazard of fragmentation on 32-bit where you have limited address space. But there's ways to mitigate that. In the future, we want to have more control over this virtual address range, being able to drop pages that are committed with mAdvise don't need, or mmap a file into that memory so you can do direct file access through memory. So third way to think about this is just as a JavaScript feature. If we give the ability to efficiently load and cache large code and predictably get native performance, this is a powerful library building tool. So you might ask, what use does JavaScript have for compiled libraries? And the cool thing is we can answer this by looking at what people are doing today by compiling to JavaScript. People are doing client-side image compression. So what you upload is a small image that you've compressed on the client side instead of uploading the large image that you compress on the server side. That's what Facebook does. Or client-side image filtering, or 3D mapping, or language detection, which is actually in Firefox using compiled JavaScript. Facial recognition, if with Get User Media you can get the webcam and run a computer vision algorithm, and we saw a site that was finding your eyes and putting sunglasses on them that you were considering purchasing. Client-side crypto is done by Mega. Compression, audio mixing, lots of examples here. And that's before getting into games and simulations, which are the classic, heavy-hitting, big compiled use cases. And the fourth way to think about this is the evolution of asm.js. So what is asm.js? It's an extraordinarily optimizable, low-level subset of JavaScript that can be compiled from languages like C++. And because it's just JavaScript, it runs well on all browsers today, and all those use cases I was just talking about are using it. And currently, in addition to hitting the sweet spot of normal type specializing JITs, Firefox and Edge have special asm.js optimizations that recognize that it is in this subset and give it an extra performance boost. And Chrome reports that their optimizations are also in development. So how do you get asm.js? Well, there's an open source tool called mscripten, and it plugs into the end of LVM. So you take your C++, you compile it with a normal C++ compiler. It's the one that ships now in OS X. Feed that into mscripten, and that generates JavaScript. And that way, you're getting all the optimizations that happen in the C++ compiler. And at the end, you just have basically a bunch of loads and stores that you can compile to JavaScript. So what does that look like? So this is a sample asm.js module I'm going to walk through bit by bit. So first, we wrap the whole thing in a big JavaScript function. That's the closure or the module pattern you see in JavaScript. And we wrap it in a closure. You have some encapsulation of all this local state. Then we have this hint. It doesn't actually change the behavior, but it tells the engine, hey, you should look at this code. It's probably this optimizable asm.js. Then this is our form of imports. You basically copy in things you want to call from the outside world into your closure. Now, this is what people usually assume, and might make sense, is that you would represent like C++ malloc or C++ objects as JavaScript objects, but not at all. We represent it as a big array of bytes. And so the whole heap is just one big typed array, and things like malloc, they just allocate sections of this big typed array. And that's like, you know, the critical piece that allows it to do C++ and JavaScript efficiently. On the other hand, C++ functions do turn into JavaScript functions. We declare their types with a coercion, which says this is an integer. Declare their for local variables, we declare their type with a with just its initializer. Here we're doing a load, and the way we do that is by taking an integer index, which is our pointer, and indexing into this big typed array. And since the typed array is indexed by int32s, we have to do this right shift to divide it by 4, because we're indexing by int32s, which has the unintended effect of auto-aligning your memory accesses, which maybe you didn't want to do, something we can fix in WebAssembly. This is the definition of, this is how you do an addition. We force you to coerce it back to an integer, which has the wraparound semantics that map precisely to a single add instruction. And lastly, if you want to pass this out to outside JavaScript that doesn't conform to asm.js, you can just call it. And lastly, you return the asm.js functions that you want to be able to call from normal asm.js. So you have your imports, a bunch of computation, loads and stores, and then your exports. And if you stick to this subset, we can compile the JavaScript ahead of time without running it at all. Normally with JavaScript, you want to run it, see what types are flowing through, and that way you can generate type-specialized code. But with this, the types are completely evident in the syntax. We can compile it ahead of time. Also, we can compile it in parallel. We can fork out all those individual functions into a bunch of parallel compilation tasks, and we can cache the machine code. And this is what we did a few years ago, and if you're interested more, we can read a blog post on this subject. So just to give a little bit of history, we started this kind of research project in 2009, compiling C++ to JavaScript, and it just got faster and faster as like the performance wars heated up. And then we saw mscripten was doing a great job. We were like, well, what's the limit? How far can we take JavaScript? So that was the asm.js project, was a research question of how, you know, what's the limit for this compiled JavaScript? So that was asm.js. We were able to see, you know, huge speedups. So we published the subset so other browsers could do the same optimizations and other compilers could target the same subset. And we shipped the optimizations in Firefox and showed this on some pretty large game engines like, you know, Unreal and Unity. And then, you know, in the present, you know, a bunch of companies are using it for games and all sorts of tasks. And the motivations when we say why are people using this? One is just to avoid plugins. People, you know, plugins are on a clear deprecation path for the web, and you know, they have other problems, security problems. They have a lot of user friction if you need them to install a plugin that they don't already have. This allows people to bring existing applications that are millions of lines of C and C++ code that would be too big to rewrite. Let's support high-performance libraries, like the ones already talked about, and get this predictable near-native performance. And based on this feedback, we've heard two big requests that have helped us extend JavaScript. One is, you know, people want to do pthreads. So we represent memory with one big array buffer, and that lives in a single, you know, single thread, basically. So the proposal, which is advancing through TC39, is shared array buffer, which is just an array buffer you can send between workers. And workers is the web versions of threads, so that means you can share one memory between threads, and we also give you the atomics and wait and wake operations to build your own synchronization primitives. The other thing people want is SIMD parallelism, and so the proposal is simd.js, which adds new data types, representing things like 4 int 32s, and then operations on these simd data types. And there is experimental support for this in Firefox Nightly and in mscripten, so you can try out both of these things today. But so that helped us, you know, move even closer to native, but we still need to go farther. So different ways we need to go farther. We need to further reduce load time. Just on mobile, we'll go back. The parse time for these huge JavaScript files can be like 10 or 20 seconds, and that's just the parsing before you've even gotten to compiling machine code. So, you know, that's not acceptable. We want to reduce the over-the-wire size. The surprising thing is that if you gzip minified asm.js and compare that to native, they're actually comparable. So we're starting kind of on par with native code, and we want to do better because we can see that it's a text format. If we have a binary encoding this, we can do a lot better. We want to reduce the runtime memory consumption for the code. Some aspects of JavaScript mean that we have to like keep the source around in case you call toSource on the JavaScript, so that takes extra runtime memory. And there's just other features like dynamic linking, memory resizing that we're constrained by JavaScript from doing kind of to the limit. And as ever, we want to keep pushing closer to native performance. The new standard lets you tweak the semantics in a way that allows you to generate faster code while still keeping safety. So WebAssembly. And so we can view this as the evolution of asm.js, where in asm.js you have to write x plus y or 0 in JavaScript. We have an add. And whereas we had to emulate 64 bits, we have an int 64 add and a whole array of int 64 operators. Whereas we do this goofy coercions for calls to make sure it was completely evident what the signature was, we just have a call. And whereas we had to do these typed array indices, we just have a load and store. And they have the property that you want, which is that they don't auto-align your pointers, which both means we don't have to emit the masking instruction to auto-align your pointers, and they behave better when you accidentally or maybe intentionally emit unaligned loads and stores. So let's take a little tour and actually see what this looks like. But first, some caveats. So this is a work in progress. That being said, we reached a recent milestone where we have a single demo that runs in Chrome, Firefox, and Edge. And so I'll try that out here on the Wi-Fi and see. So it's actually has to download maybe 5 or 10 megabytes. It just finished the compilation, so this is just a splash screen. And so this is WebAssembly code running, I don't know how many millions of lines of code, but the Unity engine. And the same demo runs in Chrome, Firefox, and Edge. So we're making progress, but we still have a lot of work to do. Also, the initial release won't be everything that we envisioned for WebAssembly. We're doing this on purpose iteratively. We want to have the first thing released that has just the minimum viable product, and that minimum viable product is basically be better asm.js. Compile C and C++, and then we have a roadmap of things we want to do, but we'll be able to take into account feedback and iterate and correct. That also means, of course, that we can use asm.js to polyfill the transition to WebAssembly. If you don't have WebAssembly yet in your browser, you can just use asm.js. So if we go back to this demo, we can just as well run it as asm.js, and it'll be using the JavaScript support that's been in all, that runs in all the browsers and has been for a while. Also, the entire text format is under construction because it's highly derivative of what's the actual language that we're defining, and that's been changing. So for now, I'll use this temporary S expression syntax that we've been using inside of the GitHub repo that we're doing all the spec work on. And so the basic idea of S expressions is if you have an AST, it's what we see on the left, you write it in a pre-order which uses a lot of parentheses, and this is basically Lisp syntax. And we totally realized that Lisp said the same thing, that this is a temporary syntax, and they got committed to it. So we understand that. Fortunately, what's that? Yeah, I mean, it's lovely to parse. I mean, that part I love. But fortunately, it's so verbose, I think it's really going to push us hard to come up with an infix syntax that has curly braces and a little more approachable. And this is also, this S expression syntax is what we're using in our reference interpreter, and we have a rather large test suite that actually writes tests in this language. So this is the current operating temporary text language. Lastly, there's a bunch of other things that are speculative or not yet implemented, and I marked those with Unicode Snowman. So let's start with some C code. Simplest C function, don't worry, we'll see something a little more computational later. And it's just C function, and the way to think about this is as a DLL. And so if you want to call something from outside, you need to export it, so you mark it with an export, just like you would in a native DLL build. And you would mark that the same way you would mark an export from an actual DLL. In this case, you know, for Clang or GCC, you set the ELF visibility to default. And then once you've done that, you just compile it. So you know, here with Unicode Snowman, we haven't integrated this yet into the actual Clang compiler driver, but we do have an upstream WebAssembly backend for LVM in progress that's able to compile code like this. So the eventual vision would be that you know, you'll just get a standard Clang, and you'll be able to say, I want WASM, compile the C file, and then out will pop your .wasm file. And it should be, like for this code, like you know, 15 bytes. So as I said, there's a one-to-one text format. So let's see what this bad boy looks like. So we call our WASM you know, to text and look at the code. And so the first to note is this, the whole thing is a module. That's the unit of code in WebAssembly. We have our definition of a function. And that's ugly. And so we see we've named it, but those names are erased. That's just like labels in assembly code. They turn into integers. And then we declare our parameters and their types and the return type. Then we do our I32 add. And these things that look like local variables, we can think of them as virtual registers. So we get the register left-hand side and the right-hand side, and we do an add. And the result of this expression is the result of the return value of the function. And then we say we export it. So that would be the actual WebAssembly code for this trivial function. So how do we load that in a browser? So here I'm using pretty much all existing JavaScript APIs. The only thing new here is this wasm.instantiate module. So what we're doing here is we're just fetching this file, just like a blob of bytes, and this using the new fetch API. And when we get the response, we say, OK, I want to read this as an array buffer. Just give me the bytes. And we make a view of it. And we pass that into this JavaScript function. It says compile the bytes. We get back an instance. And then we call it just by calling what's just a JavaScript function. So we call add, pass the one, the two, they get coerced to what WebAssembly wants, computes the result, returns it, should be three, and alerts it. So we can actually run that now. Ta-da, that ran WebAssembly, all you know, 5 bytes of it. So the fun thing is we also have just the most basic integration with the debugger. So we open the debugger tab and do it. And then we can see here, we've dynamically compiled this WASM, so it's not like it doesn't have a URL, just because it's like an eval, really. So we use the kind of the same syntax. When you eval some code, we eval this WASM. And then you see, we want to be very clear, this is not the final format. So here you can see roughly the same syntax. Now this is auto-generated, so we auto-generated a name. Oh, make it bigger. Darn it. I don't know how to make the DevTools text bigger. I'll just basically, it looks like what we just saw on the last slide, but you can see. It would be if it was a web page without the DevTools. Does it also work that way? Oh, it does. That's so sensible. Awesome. So you can see, you know, it's roughly the same thing. A few things were synthesized here, like some names, but it's roughly the same stuff. And you know, if I try to set a breakpoint, oh, that doesn't work yet, because we haven't implemented the actual debugger interop. But basically, you'll be able to put a breakpoint here, you know, click the button and break here and step through it just like it was like JavaScript. So let's talk about some interesting stuff that we can improve on this in the future. So first thing is there's the Streams API coming, which exposes streams to JavaScript. So when you do a network request, you don't have to wait for the entire thing to finish before you compile. You can get a stream back, which is you can get the bytes as they come. So when we get our response, we ask for a reader, which is like the stream, and we feed that into our same WASM instantiate module. It returns a promise. It's implicitly being returned here. And that promise will resolve to the instance. So we're taking this off the main thread. We can do this async compilation. And so we call instantiate module, given a stream. And as the bytes are being downloaded, we're able to compile it. And when it's done, it gives us the instance, and we can call it just like normal before. So that allows us to overlap download and compilation. Another way to integrate is with the ES6 module system. So just now, finally, you know, we're soon getting the ability to use ES6 modules actually in the browser. And the way you do that is by you have a script tag and this type equal module. And so this is some JavaScript code here using ES6. And it says import add from demo.wasm. And so this is a WASM module that we're importing. But since there's a high compatibility between ES6 modules and then WASM modules, you just grab the add export. And so this is much simpler to be able to pull out a function from a WASM module. And you can imagine composing a whole modular program with some modules being WASM and some modules being JavaScript. Also, WebAssembly can call JavaScript. So let's go back to the C code. What does that look like? Again, the analogy here is it's like a DLL import. So just like we have a declare a function and we say it's going to be imported and then we call it, that's our entire C file. And we mark the symbol as a DLL import like we would for a native build. And we compile it the same way as before. And we look at the text and now we see there's an import statement that says, you know, imports this printent, it has this type. So we locally assign a type to this thing. We call this import and pass it 42. And instead of exporting this function, there's a start function. This is kind of like the main of this module. When you load it, you know, you run the start function. And that was because we actually had a main in this C program. And so, go ahead.
So you said this is like a DLL. How do you make sure that the thing that you call really does return a param I32?
Oh yeah, great question. So if it's calling JavaScript, we just call a 2int32 conversion. So JavaScript's, you know, super malleable. You give me any value, I can call this conversion, and either that will throw, or it'll give me something. It might be zero, but it'll be an int32. So yeah, we force it. And now, if two WebAssembly models are linked together, we can actually issue like a load time validation error and say, you've export a function that has this type, and you import a function that has this type. They don't match up. So it'd be a load time validation error. So now we want to have some JavaScript that we can call. So this is another ES6 module that simply exports the printint function. And now we compile our code. And the difference is, actually, this imports goes to the last code. Ignore that first little imports.js. This little thing is standalone. We can just define an object with a field with the right name, and it has a function. And then we just pass that in to instantiate module. And that's how we pass in, you know, JavaScript that gets imported by the WebAssembly module. Alternatively, with the ES6 integration, we can simply have one line, a script type equal module, but here the URL is WASM. So just like we would load an ES6 module with a script type, with script tag, we could just load a WASM module. And that'll run the start function when it would have run the top-level ES6 script. And then just due to recursive nature of imports, this WASM module will then import this imports.js, and then, you know, it'll just work. So that would just be a one-liner without any JavaScript to load a WASM module. Now let's look at an actual kind of computation. So here's a C function that sums, you know, some ints. So here's the whole thing, and already we can see, you know, big opportunity to compress with a non-S expression syntax, but we'll break this up into pieces. So we start with this local variable int, and because nobody takes the address of it, it is not an aliased variable, we can stick it in one of our virtual registers, which is what we call a local. So a local has a type. And again, it has a name here, but this name is erased in the binary. It's just an index. And then we use getLocal to read the register, and we pass that to an add, and then we can do a setLocal to write to the register. But again, since this, you know, we treat this as a register, and because there's so few locals, well, this will definitely, the compiler will actually put this in a register. Next, for our pointers, as with asm.js, they're just integers, offsets into this big linear memory. So we pass in two integers as our I and end pointer. And then when we want to load from it, we read the register and do a load. That's it. For our loop, an interesting difference is in a high-level language, you actually want your loop construct to loop for you. In WASM, we just want to be able to create labels and branch to them. So if you want a back edge, you use a loop, which basically says push two labels, one at the beginning, or actually one at the end, and one at the beginning, and then you branch to the beginning. So this thing just pushes labels on a stack that get popped at the end. And this thing is your actual jump, which jumps to the top of the loop. So a little different, but this is because it's a low-level kind of assembly-like design. For our loop condition, we want a branch if, so a conditional branch. We branch conditionally to the end of the loop, which is the break label, if I is equal to the end. And for our increments, you know, we read the register, we add 4. And the 4, why? Because we're actually scooting over 4 bytes at a time. Another instance of this being a low-level language. And write it back to the register I. And we're done. Yeah, so that's, you know, hopefully this conveys some of the idea of, you know, we have branches and we have typed arithmetic. And that was just one function. We stick that in a module. This module declares it as one page of memory. We fix the page size to 64K. We export the memory so we can actually let JavaScript access the memory directly, and that's an option we have. We have our function defined as it was in the last slide, and we export that function. So that's the whole module. Now we compile this module just as before, but the cool thing now is we can access memory, and it's just an array buffer. That allows JavaScript to see our linear memory. So we create an int32 array on that buffer, and then walk through, and we just write 10 ints. That's our input to the program. And then when we call it, we need to pass the pointers, but the pointers are just offsets. So, you know, the beginning is, you know, zero, the very first thing we wrote to, and then the end pointer is 10 integers over, so 10 times 4 bytes each. That's the end of our little tour. And what we've seen, we can call into and out of JavaScript, future hopeful streams and ES6 module integration, and a little bit of computation. But what about APIs? How do we reach out and touch the world? So on a traditional platform, you know, you have a VM, and it has your GC compiler, and you load all your code into it some way. And it accesses a bunch of APIs, and these mediate your access to the actual underlying systems, audio, graphics, input. And when I first started working on Firefox 7 years ago, I thought, well, the web's totally different than that. You know, it's fundamentally you have this document, and you have all these tags, and then the JavaScript VM, it's just reaching out and touching the tags, and that's your indirect way of sort of like getting to the actual underlying system. And that was right, like, you know, a decade or two ago. But the web's changed a lot since then. You can actually look at it in the way it's implemented as just a VM that has its bytecode is JavaScript, and that's a little different, but it has this architecture of you have a VM. And you have these old APIs, the DOM and CSSOM, however you say that. But you have all these new APIs came with HTML5 and beyond that allow you more direct access to all these underlying system facilities. So it's starting to resemble a virtual platform. Of course, it has some awesome webby properties that we love the web for, like you can load any app just by loading a URL. And the script tags are how you load code into your VM. But we also have this special fast path that skips the whole VM and APIs and goes straight to layout and rendering for declarative documents. And we have this cool same origin sandboxing that lets us feel safe when we browse the web, and of course standards and multiple invitations. So it's a very webby VM, but it is a VM. So when you add WebAssembly, how does that fit in? It's just another sibling to JavaScript. It's the same VM, the same APIs, just one more way to kind of load code into the VM. So what are WebAssembly APIs? Well, the answer is just they're web APIs. Where we don't want to implement a whole new API surface or fork, you know, the web's VM. And this is the key difference from plugin architectures and an important part of the WebAssembly design. So with that question, how do we actually get to the APIs from WebAssembly? So today, you know, in the minimum viable product that we're initially going to be shipping with, the only way you get out is by calling JavaScript. So that's how you do it. You thunk into JavaScript, and then you call your APIs. And that's suboptimal. You know, you waste some time calling through. Usually it's amortized by the actual cost of what you're calling to. But it works, and that's what we've been doing for a few years now with asm.js. And that's what the demo is doing, and that runs fine. So it's a fine starting point. It's functional. But we want to do better. In the future, we want to be able to support calling it web APIs directly, just from WASM into the browser's native implementation. And so I'm going to give this one two snowmans, because this is like kind of farther out. You know, it's probably a next year thing. But how might this work? Well, we can import a type from the environment. So WebAssembly itself does not depend on the actual browser, so it does not natively know about like these types, like WebGL rendering context or WebGL buffers. So you have to import them. The environment can choose to export these types. So you would import a type for a rendering context, and that's, I'm choosing WebGL as the example here. And you, once you have that type, you can use it as parameters in your imports and your functions, and this kind of represents an opaque reference. Similarly, you have a buffer type, and this can be used in signatures and in our locals. And then we import this function create. We're saying, like, give me the function that is the WebGL rendering context.create buffer. And that's just imported from the environment. We can imagine this coming, importing this directly from the browser's native implementation. And then here in our implementation, in our actual WebAssembly code, we can just call this import. We can, you know, take the context, call this method, which creates us a buffer, and then we can go to town on the buffer and do all the sorts of things you want to do, calling directly into the browser from this WebAssembly code. So this would be one way to think about it, is just being able to import these functions and types from the environment. And for more details, we have a doc in the design repo they can check out. And so what does this look like from C++? Like, that's fine at the low level. How do we get to this? So this actually kind of works today. Mscript basically maps common C++ libraries to web APIs as an implementation detail of those libraries. So, you know, two popular libraries. One is, you know, SDL, which a lot of native developers use just to portably get to input and how do I get a graphics context. SDL is implemented, 1 and 2, if I understand right, STDIO. So this is just plain vanilla C code, runs the same on native. We can feed this directly today into mscripten, and so no snowman. That's MCC is the compile driver of MScript. And in its C's, we're generating an HTML file. And it says, in addition to actually generating the code, I'm going to generate the scaffolding, the JavaScript glue that gets us in and out of web APIs. And when you compile that, you know, you get actually what I've embedded here is an iframe. We have the context here. And we have a full screen button, so we can go take that context full screen. And our standard out is by default piped to a little text area. But that's just the HTML scaffolding. If I pull up DevTools, still big, good, and find this little thing. You know, we have our canvas. Let me find it. You know, we have an iframe, and you know, it just has a canvas, and that's the actual thing that we render to. And if you want a full screen app, that's really all you want is that canvas. You can take your standard out and put it anywhere, but a text area is a fine place, and you can just hack on this directly if you need to. And then you have the actual code that connects to these things. That's like the default harness that you get. Right, so beyond compiling just C and C++, we've been talking about that the whole time. WebAssembly initially only has this linear memory, it's a big array of bytes. And that's good if your language has a low-level memory model like C, C++, Fortran, and Rust. But if you have a language that has a GC, you know, the mapping is not so direct. Now, sure, you can implement a GC on top of linear memory, like they're just bytes. You have a Turing-complete language, go for it. Yeah, but this has technical downsides. One, you're gonna have to ship more code, it's gonna be heavier weight. You know, the intended models, we have lots of apps in a single, lots of libraries in a single web app. And, you know, if each one of them has their own little GC, you know, it's a lot of aggregate waste if people are using this for lots of little small libraries. You miss all these browser GC optimizations, all these integrations, like, you know, we integrate incremental GC with the rendering loop, so that way your slices end when it's time to draw the next frame, all that stuff you would miss out on. Probably requires some sort of shadow stack, so that way when you want to do marking, you can, because the stack is trusted, you can't just walk down the stack and look at what's on the stack. You'd have to write all your pointers to like the shadow stack, which is gonna be slower. And this is, you know, maybe the real killer that's hard to, the other things are like suboptimal, but you won't be able to collect cycles into and out of browser objects. So if you have a cycle that goes from one of your GC objects into the DOM and then comes back, but it's not otherwise reachable, you'll accidentally end up rooting it and it won't be able to collect it. So for all these reasons, you know, the web already has a GC. It's JavaScript GC, can't we just use that? And yes, we want to. So, you know, this is on the roadmap, super speculative. So how might this look? Just like before, we would import a type, but this time won't be opaque. We're not importing from the environment. We'd have built-in description of what this GC type looks like. Here we're saying, okay, it's a struct type with two fields. One's an int, the other one's a pointer to the same type we're defining. So this would be sort of a linked list of ints. And we can use that type to declare our parameters, our results, other things. And then we want to read a field from this. It would be a new operator that reads, like in this case, the integer field. And you know, this is just a little sketch, but the idea is we want to provide low-level GC primitives like struct types and array types and avoid baking in one language's class model. We also need some fundamental extensions to the GC. And this would be the same GC that's used by JavaScript and WebAssembly if we want to be able to compile languages like Java. So you know, first we want typed objects. And you can think of these as just fixed structure JavaScript objects, like a stronger object.seal. In addition to preventing you from adding or removing properties, it doesn't let you change the type of properties. And this would be how we reflect one of these struct types to JavaScript when it flows out to JavaScript, because we want to allow you to be able to pass GC objects back and forth. So we'd need this way to reflect a WebAssembly kind of GC object to JavaScript. Also want postmortem notification to basically tell me when an object is dead. And this would be used to implement finalizers. And it's also been a thing we've wanted for a long time. If you want to take a C API that has like, allocate this thing, use it, free this thing, that's how a C API usually works, and you want to wrap this with a JavaScript object so it's nice to use, well, you need to know when the JavaScript object's no longer reachable so you can go and call the free, otherwise you'd be leaking. And we've wanted this in asm.js for a long time. Also weak references to implement weak references. Beyond compiling, to go even beyond that, that would help us for statically typed GC languages. To do efficient job with dynamic languages, we need to go even farther. We need to be able to patch things, like that's what JITs do. Patch constants, branch targets, return addresses, do fine-grained compilation, be able to inject those into a module, good support for dynamic, any, and kind of union type values. And these look like features that would violate the safety portability that we're saying was so important in the beginning. But we feel like with careful abstraction, these can be made safe and portable. An example of this is Invoke Dynamic in Java. They took a particular problem, you know, when able to patch call sites to dispatch to a number of type-specialized callees, and they defined this in a safe, abstract way that didn't actually expose the underlying machine code or the absolute addresses or allow you to, like, crash the VM or anything. And, but just to be clear, this is several years away. This is just saying the roadmap that, that we're imagining this evolving along.
Question. Oh, you're at the end. So one of the issues with like basically just using the GC for, you know, in the browser to replace like a language's GC is that like any performance tuning that you might do, like, you know, during development just sort of goes out the window. Like all the GC flags that you're used to, like, you know, like turning the knobs for, that's just like gone.
Like if you're tuning it for like a JVM and I know that.
Or like, whatever, you know, choose your whatever language, right? That would go out the window. So like, is there any, can you like imagine some way to like deal with that?
But I mean, it's a really good question because I hear that is quite a fine art of GC parameter tuning. Now, one aspect of this is, you know, browser GCs are, you know, tuned with, you know, a lot of experience to specifically for, you know, client-side workloads. They're taking into account, you know, how much memory is it seeing on the system. And this is often quite different than a server environment where you know, like, the hardware configuration and you're configuring for this one environment. The browsers, you're running on, like, mobile devices, on big, beefy desktops. So in some ways, letting the browser just make some of these tuning choices could be a good thing. Sort of the GC tuning happened when the browser developers were specializing the browser for that device. So in some ways, you kind of want to take advantage of that. Now, of course, in the limit, you can do that first approach, which is compile your own GC, like, go nuts. But it's a really good question, and you know, maybe something over time. I mean, people have been talking about GC hints in JavaScript, you know, forever, because it can make this big difference. But you know, hints always have a downside, like pragmas. You know, they start off useful, they get abused, and then you end up ignoring them, or people rely on like things like register keyword being, you know, an obvious example. It's a good question. I don't have a great answer to that.
I may be misunderstanding something, but or just confused about something, but I'm curious, if you're looking towards a threading abstraction and providing shared memory between concurrent threads, I imagine you're actually talking about real actual parallel threads that would then be able to get put out to different CPUs and actually run on their own. How does that work with collection, or is that something where you'd say, that's independent, because you're talking about a collector for a language that's single-threaded, right?
That's a great question. So I think initially what we might, if we're doing this iteratively, we might constrain this so that you would end up having each thread's GC heap being independent, and the way you'd basically force that is you wouldn't have any global variables that had references. So you'd be able to allocate over here in this thread and pass them around, and allocate in this thread and pass them around, but you wouldn't be able to go between. That might be an initial step to start with single-threaded GC, get that out, get people using it, get, yes, we care about this, and then we would actually have to generalize the actual built-in browser's GC to do parallel collection, which is what Java does, of course, and people are asking for that in JavaScript, too. But that would be a thing we'd have to do incrementally and being very intentional about saying, yes, we're actually going to need multi-threaded GC now. But that's pretty intimidating right now because we've specialized a lot on single-threaded GCs, but it's definitely a possible path in the future. And I know some particular people are interested in, some people have wondered for JavaScript or these typed objects, maybe you could share them because they have fixed structure. So a lot of the hard things about sharing JavaScript objects between threads go away. They're not these big complicated hash tables. They're just like a Java object. So it is a thing we'd have to worry about, yeah.
Are there any plans for a standalone implementation, say in ANSI C?
Oh, of a WebAssembly engine? Yeah, so that's a big part of design I haven't touched on. I've been kind of specializing and focusing only on the web use case, is just like JavaScript is not specialized to the browser, it kind of has this host abstraction, the definition of WebAssembly is the same, and we totally anticipate use cases where people will make just a WebAssembly VM, and it won't have all the rest of the browsers. It might not even have a GC, and it would run in, you know, maybe some minimal device. Or
is minimal tens of kilobytes?
I mean, it's hard to speculate at this moment, but I'll say this: compared to a JavaScript engine, the implementation burden is far less. And you also have a lot of, you know, depending on what this non-web environment is, you might be able to do all your compilation from WebAssembly bytecode to machine code ahead of time, like when you first populate the device, when you first download the code. It could be really quite low. At the end of the day, we're, you know, what's the fundamental things? It has to be safe, unless you wanted to break the standard, but you know, it has to be safe, so it needs those machine checks. But other than that, it's really quite comparable to native code in the memory usage, because it's just linear memory, and the code, compared to like what you would get from a C compiler. So it could, but hard to say without any existing implementations to point to.
Quick question about the last thread of slides that you have, the beyond C and C++. And this may be a naive and stupid question, but wouldn't it be easier to take languages like Ruby, Python, things like that are very high level and duck typed and garbage collected, and transpile them to ES6, then to WebAssembly?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great point.
So why target WebAssembly at all?
Right, so for those particular languages?
For those, not for C.
Now, an interesting point, if we take any particular language, the problem is when two dynamic languages' core types, like number, don't precisely match, that's when things get crazy slow. Like, if you have a number type that's an IEEE 754 double, great, I've got a perfect translation to JavaScript. But if you have, or Python, you have like big ints, you know, or something, you end up having to like generate, the JavaScript generate is like branch on every single thing. Now, that's even going to be a hard challenge, you know, hard thing to compile to for WebAssembly, because you'd also have to do all these branchings. But, you know, you might just compile an interpreter. And then if you're going to do an interpreter like CPython, that actually you're not using the GC at all. You're just, you know, compiling, you know, you're doing your own GC. But for an interpreter, WebAssembly would be great. It'll add a lot of predictable performance, because ultimately you're compiling C code to WebAssembly. That's just interpreting the Python. So I think the most successful dynamic languages are the ones that basically take JavaScript semantics, and then they kind of introduce various things that desugar to JavaScript in a direct way, like TypeScript, perfect example, and like CoffeeScript and all these other star scripts. They basically are designed to go to JavaScript, and those ones would continue, I think, to go to JavaScript. JavaScript's an ideal compilation target to them. This actually relates to a FAQ question I'll get to in just a sec, but JavaScript, I think, will still be a good compile target for a lot of these dynamic languages.
Yep. And now on this side. I've been following the re-litigation recently of Java and or rather of Android, and I'm curious, since you are putting out yet another technology for the web, whether any of the fallout from this re-litigation hits you.
I don't know enough about the legal aspects. I haven't seen anything so far. So
okay, yeah, just the question of whether interfaces are now copyrightable and whether that, yeah.
Well, fortunately, our interfaces are just the web APIs, right? So that's, we're not introducing a new thing there.
The important point is W3C owns the web APIs. Therefore, there's no copyright issue. As opposed to Java, where Java Sun, well, now Oracle, owns, claims to own the copyright.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, so reason we love the web is... Oh, so you're saying if you're compiling Java to WebAssembly, is that the particular point?
There's a particular... The assertion made by Oracle is that the Java APIs, I'm trying to phrase this carefully, is that the Java APIs are copyright and property of Oracle. Well, were property of Sun and now property of Oracle. Mm-hmm. However, in this case, it would appear to a layperson that since the API is a W3C spec, then nobody effectively owns the APIs.
I'm not a lawyer, but it sounds great to me. So some frequently asked questions, in addition to all these great ones. How do I compile WebAssembly today? Same tool I used to compile asm.js. Because it's so similar, it was not a lot of work to adapt this, you know, WEM script into generate WebAssembly. And the particular backend tool is called Binarian. And if you go there, you'll find they actually have, it's like a whole Swiss Army knife of stuff you might want to do to WASM. You can go all the different directions between all the different things. So basically, if you have an existing project today that works with asm.js, the transition story is basically like set a flag. When can I use WebAssembly? So we're still iterating on this V1 spec, which would be the initial thing that would get shipped in browsers. And we, of course, need to nail down that text format. Good thing, though, is the text format is something we output, not something that we're needing to parse. So it's a lot less integral to it, to the whole design than you might guess saying such a thing. So hopefully we'll be able to do that before without too much time. Also, we'll need a quiet time after the spec is stable to like collect feedback, let all the implementations collect, make sure the test suite covers a lot. We already have quite a few thousand lines of test cases, but we're going to really want to beef that up. But with all those caveats and with the usual standardization caveats that anyone can, you know, monkey wrenches can come at any time, we do want to see the first browser shipping this year. So that's an informal but tentative and shared target. How will WebAssembly be used? This we can also answer by looking at what people are doing with asm.js today. And there's a spectrum that you see. And on the one end of the spectrum, you have the whole thing, WebAssembly driving one big canvas ports. You know, you had a big application, and you know, games are an example, VR apps, things that have totally custom UI. What I hope does not happen is re-implementations based on CSS. Like, I've seen some of these tried, and they'll initially, you know, they'll have some certain good performance characteristics, but you start to play with them and you're like, there's a lot of value in HTML and CSS, a lot of native integration, a lot of like UI stuff. So that's the one I don't expect, and I think you'll kind of have a bad time if you try to go that direction. But if you're doing custom UI, if you have a video game which has totally done its own UI, like that's one definite point in the spectrum, the extreme point.
Along the line of the HTML CSS integration, do you actually foresee the WebAssembly native APIs for DOM and CSS manipulation?
Yeah, all that stuff. It basically, I think, what we want to think about this as you know, there's WebIDL, which sits in between all of our web APIs and JavaScript. And the cool thing is, we did all this work defining WebIDL, rationalizing all these peculiarities of JavaScript, but we've ended up with a nice, firm interface. So the way we want to think about it is there's JavaScript binding to WebIDL, and then a WebAssembly binding to WebIDL. It'll be the IDL, like the name implies. So WebIDL exists for all the DOM interfaces, so yeah, we'd be able to go directly to DOM objects and stuff like that from WebAssembly.
Hi. This technology, how will it work with the currently existing web browser testing technology, like Selenium? It will still work the way it is, or you need something additional thing to like some kind of adaptive layer to work with it?
Yeah, that's a good question. The hope is, because it's not adding anything other than just a new form of code, everything else would be the same. You know, it's not a whole new VM, it's not a whole bunch of new APIs. If there's a maybe there's a compilation step now to compile some WebAssembly, but other than that, it should be kind of quite symmetric to JavaScript. So my hope is it wouldn't be a significant change there, other than maybe a compilation step is introduced.
There's this thing you might have heard of called Macromedia Flash. It's its own VM. You know, it's got assembly, and it's got even got an interpreted language that's remarkably similar to JavaScript. Has anyone made this observation, and what are your thoughts?
It's a funny story. I think ES4 was attempting to unify the two, so there would be, I think if you look back on our Mozilla wiki from like 2004, we wanted to like use their VM. It was called like Action Monkey and Spider Monkey and ActionScript together. And ES4 is going to add namespaces and all the things, it's going to be this grand, and then it all fell apart and collapsed, and then we had to skip ES4 and go to ES5. So yeah, the languages are similar. We actually had a project in Mozilla Research called Shumway, which was, can we translate ActionScript to JavaScript? And if you don't care about being correct, we can go faster than ActionScript, you know? and you can almost be right for a lot of code, actually. It's just these certain core things, like the namespaces are like a permeating thing. It's like everything needs to get slower to handle, like what if there's two namespaces and all this stuff. So the translation, if you want to be correct, is a lot slower. And to be fast, you'd have to do crazy jitting stuff in JavaScript to jit JavaScript. So Shumway was a hard direction, and we played with that a lot. I don't think there's going to be an automatic port story from if you have a bunch of ActionScript. I wish I had a better answer there, but.
That was a good answer. The whole Shumway thing, I didn't see how that fit in, but that was cool. Thank you.
Cool. Yeah.
Not huge fans of C and C++.
Because they suck.
Can we please have things like tail recursion?
Great question, yeah. So tail recursion is, I think, something we want to add as an explicit operator.
Good,
it's
that's
a tail
fine.
Call this.
That's
and it's fine. On the list of future features, and we definitely hear like the Scheme guys totally want tail recursion. They've been having heck trying to compile to JavaScript, which also got tail calls in ES6, and that's on a recent discussion. But anyways, yes, tail calls.
Okay, good.
It's the thing we want one day. Hopefully not too far.
I'm curious how committed you and the guys at Google are to keeping the standard consistent, because even till this day, some of your browsers have certain methods that some don't, and they're not officially in the spec, but they're out there.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, the web surface area is just enormous. There's a strong interest in having very good compatibility. Like, the amount of collaboration on WebAssembly, like, shocks a lot of people who've seen, you know, previous things. Like, four people involved in the thing from the beginning is... That itself is kind of pretty rare. And so, you know, our weapons to combat this is like really extensive test suite. Like other areas, the things that went pretty well is WebGL, which had a huge, very extensive test suite. We're going to be doing that. And the cool thing is we can hit it from so many angles. We can use C fuzzers to generate WebAssembly to fuzz the browsers. So fuzzing is at our disposal. Like we have a bunch of compiler writers who really love the corner cases of like, you know, IEEE 754, you know, so we have a pretty extensive test suite too. And so, you know, the goal is, and also we have this reference interpreter, which is kind of like, we want the code to be like as a spec. It's written in OCaml, and it's trying to be kind of definitional in nature. So we're doing a lot of things to try to make the compatibility really high here. So. So from the one big canvas port, the next kind of level on the spectrum is you have a big canvas that's driven by WebAssembly, but you are using JavaScript and Chrome around this. And we see this in Unity games that are in Facebook, where the Facebook Chrome is, of course, HTML stuff all around it. And then you have this Unity game in the middle. Or, you know, we have an application from Autodesk that's did all of their actual UI in HTML and CSS. Stepping down, you have WebAssembly driving an engine, but it's not actually going directly to a big old canvas. It's just doing computation, and it's being fed into other things that are, you know, written in a today's kind of modern JS style. And then even going further, we have the usage of just libraries, where it's pretty much entirely just a modern JS web app, but you're using WebAssembly just to do particular computations. We have AmmoJS, which is a physics engine, SQLite, compiled to JS if you really want an in-memory relational database, language detection, all sorts of things. And then lastly, on the opposite end of the spectrum, I think a lot of people may end up getting this just implicitly through using popular JS frameworks. So a pretty, you know, you might think, well, it's all just about DOM manipulation, but all the recent developments in this direction of shadow DOM is basically setting up these little virtual machines that are inside of your JS framework. And virtual machines are actually pretty good, could be a good use of WebAssembly, especially if we can add these API integrations. So we actually have some early experiments in Ember's, you know, VM that runs inside that basically propagates changes in your model to compute minimal changes to the DOM. So I think it could get to a lot of web developers through frameworks. It's probably a good time to. Yeah,
you mentioned compatibility, and I was wondering, are you concerned in the future, going forward, you will improve the language, improve, add new stuff, and you'll probably try to be backward compatible. But mm-hmm. what about forward compatibility? If I'm running like an older browser, mm-hmm. will everything just break, or how do you think about that?
Yeah, so backwards compatibility for darn sure. That's the don't break the web. Forward compatibility, you know, the two way, what we see people do today is you do a feature test, and we definitely want to support feature testing. And then you basically, you know, people one way or another say like, well, if you don't have the feature, I'll do the slower thing. Or if you don't have this feature, I'll serve you the, you know, the older version that doesn't use this feature. And basically, people do ad hoc things, but they take advantage of some of the things of the web that you can, you know, feature test, that it's the whole thing is there's not a big monolithic version. WebAssembly won't have one big monolithic version. So you will be able to feature test and say, well, if this API is missing, then, you know, call this instead. With streams, there's possibilities that people will be able to rewrite some of the WebAssembly bytes as it's coming in and say, oh, you don't have the SIMD op, well, I'll rewrite it in terms of this. And it really depends on what the feature is. Like little micro features, you can do one type of thing. A whole big feature like tail recursion, maybe you're just going to ship them a totally different code base that doesn't use tail recursion. And in that way, it's sort of symmetric to the web today, where some feature is just so essential that you're going to have to do something completely different if it's not present. But we're trying to follow like the cues that we see in the rest of the web platform on this particular issue. What about source maps? I want to be able to see the language I compiled to WebAssembly, not this actual WebAssembly text language. And this, we think, is a critical piece to make compiled languages feel first class. So, you know, a good starting place would be actual source maps integration, be able to ship with WebAssembly module some binary source map and plug into all the existing infrastructure that's in the dev tools that show source maps. However, we probably need to go beyond that to provide a truly first class experience, because source maps, you know, they let you step through the code by mapping kind of PCs back and forth. But if you want to be able to say, like, print a value and then see like the value like in a way that makes sense in your source language, you know, we need to be able to give more power to the actual compiler. And there's a bunch of ways to think about doing this. Experimentation is ongoing, and, you know, probably too early to say what the right strategy is, but it's definitely something that we're looking at. Can we make JS faster by compiling to WebAssembly? Nope, because you'd just be re-implementing a JS engine in WebAssembly. And the browser already does that, and has a really good one that uses like every dirty low-level trick that you can imagine. So, no, that WebAssembly won't make existing JavaScript code faster in that respect. Will WebAssembly replace JavaScript? Nope, I don't think so. And reasons being, JS is huge, unimaginably large, has growing momentum, and a really vibrant ecosystem. And it remains, has this privileged status on the web of being the only source language that is integrated in kind of in every place in the web platform. And you have a lot of APIs that are meant to like really match well, like, you know, the way the prototypes of JS work are particularly integrated. So it has this privileged status that I think will give it this fundamental advantage. And in fact, WebAssembly might have the opposite effect. Let's say you have a project and you want a scripting language. Like, pretty common thing in a big code base, you say, I'm going to do my scripting language and then have all my C++ over here. JS might actually make, this might help make JS be the natural choice because, you know, when you're going to run on a native build, you would just compile on a JavaScript VM, and those are really fast. And if you run on the web, you get to use the browser's JavaScript VM, so it might give an extra, might actually give an extra reason to use JavaScript, and particularly for the purpose it was designed for, which is scripting. So yeah, that was the end. Thanks, and happy to have any more questions.
Well, does anyone have more questions? I think the floor is still open. If the mics are still open, if anyone has any last thoughts. Okay, yeah, you go ahead and go to the mic, please.
Kind of an off-the-wall question, but I was, the actual native format, was that inspired at all by NACL, or?
So a lot of the people who are working on WebAssembly also worked on, or a lot of the Google people who work on WebAssembly also worked on NACL, so we have a lot of experience there. They actually wrote the FAQ article of why not use LVMIR as the bitcode format. They have a lot of good reasoning there. I think we get smaller code from having this particular binary format, and the compilation is a lot faster. But yeah, we definitely tried to learn all the lessons we could from all their experience.
Has anyone tried to take a minimal language like a scheme or Lua or something that would match and just run it inside of their browser?
Oh yeah, people have done that with asm.js today. There's lua.vm.js, you can run. I mean, it's interpreting the whole thing. So it's, you know, doing this garbage collection implemented in terms of the linear memory. But that, yeah, that runs today.
I've been answering that too. Yeah, the very small embeddable scheme interpreter, chibi scheme, will go through inscripting properly and run in the browser.
Cool, that's great. Yeah.
So, what is fuzzing? I just heard the term and thought that was very interesting.
Fuzzing is my favorite thing, so thank you for giving the opportunity. It's, you know, use programs to automatically generate random inputs and feed it to whatever you're testing. And it's even better when you guide it based on the grammar of what that input is, and it'll go like mostly right and then go wrong at all levels. And there's an even cooler tool that we're using to fuzz WebAssembly now called AFL Fuzz. And what it does is it instruments your binary, instruments the branches. So as it runs it, it's seeing which branches it took which way. And what it wants to do is hit all the branches and all the combinations. So it's using the feedback of what branches it hit to generate better input cases to continue to go. And so we have some special integration in SpiderMonkey, so we can run like 10,000 iterations of random permutations like, you know, a second. So we really pound on this sucker, and it just finds bugs really fast. Yeah? Oh, is that like the Haskell?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's another great tool. Yeah, fuzzing's just the best. Like, I think the entire web would be far less stable if it wasn't for the invention of fuzzing.
That's cool
in
the name.
Yeah.
All right, any more questions for Luke? Then Luke has questions for you. All right, so we have our trivia slash, not trivia necessarily, but we have our quiz and our giveaway. The rules are there will be four books, so four questions. Luke has more, so he can ask them if you're interested, but the books will go. the books will go with whoever wants them to. If someone wants to leave one, then you get another question. You see how this works. Anyway, basically, raise your hand. You'll ask the question. I'll try to pick on people. I try to move around to be fair and try to cover the room. I'll pick on the first person whose hand goes up. And if you have the answer, you get a book.
Great.
And then, yes. But it goes to the person who puts their hands up. If you shout out the answer, you're sort of giving up your chance. So please don't do that. You know what? It takes a little time to read through that and think about it. But by all means, if you get the answer, then come on up at your leisure. All right? So go ahead.
All right. What is the name of Mozilla's JavaScript engine?
Sorry.
Good to call.
we agree.
No, you call. Correct.
All right. Grab a book. I'm going to run back here.
That technical one to see if anyone's really listening. How can bounce checks be eliminated from WebAssembly loads and stores on 64-bit platforms.
You already answered, so I'm right over there in the third row. You just turned your head, yes.
Just allocated one big address space, 32-bit address space.
All right, and then what happens?
What happens if I have pages that aren't maps by default that then you use the generating section?
You bet, correct.
Someone listened. Awesome, it's all yours. Come on up, take a look.
Does that mean that we're restricted to 4GB keeps for every page?
Great question. So 32 and, diversion to, this is a great question.
As long as it's not a different question, sure.
Yeah, so what we wanted to do for a while is it possible to make kind of polymorphic modules that run in either 32 or 64-bit mode, where like the pointers, there's like a size T, you know, and it's either one. The problem is the size of pointers gets baked so thoroughly into all aspects of the code. You can think of like size of can be an argument to a template, right? So that everything goes out the window unless you're completely dynamically recompiling your code at runtime. So no, we couldn't find a way that was going to be portable to make code size polymorphic. So basically, when it's not in the initial version, but we would have a 64-bit module, and it would just be a flag saying, I'm 64-bit mode. All of my things, all of my loads and stores are going to take 64-bit indices, or int64, or uint64s, and everything else is going to be 64-bit type. So it's just a declarative thing, or we have to be in one mode or the other. And for 64-bit mode, we, of course, won't be able to do the trick, because then we'd have to map, we'd have the same problem we have with 32-bit. So then we'd rely on this bounce check hoisting and stuff like that.
All right, next question.
Yeah, back to me. What is something that is different about WebAssembly compared to traditional native assembly languages? Assembly languages.
Well, there you go. Right here, sir. Go ahead.
AST, the strict AST syntax rather than the conventional this after that syntax.
Exactly, yeah, correct.
Go ahead, take a look at the books. We have two left over there.
That we are able to represent. We have this stack machine, which means like expression trees, you could think of it as, instead of being like three address form where it's like add takes two registers and a destination register, or an x86, two registers and one's clobbered with the result, in which case it's very linear. We have expression trees and it's done for size savings, and also it has the nice effect that when you view source it, you actually see expression trees.
Yep.
One's about C++.
What? But doesn't everyone? Yeah.
What is the name of the subset of JavaScript from which WebAssembly evolved?
Go right ahead.
asm.js.
Correct. What is the name of the open source C++ to asm.js or WebAssembly compiler? Or A, popular.
Matt.
Correct. Yes.
We're out of books, but well, if this book is taken, we are out of books, but we still have a question left, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, this one was the expando question, which was,
all right.
Name a use for WebAssembly you can imagine that was not already listed in this talk.
Go right ahead.
Secure execution of contracts. We'll have to talk about that later. Okay. Whether you want a restricted environment, you want a well-defined language.
You don't work on Ethereum, do you? Because the Ethereum guys are talking about the same sort of deal.
Who?
Ethereum? It's like a blockchain sort of cool thing.
Okay, so Ethereum. Think as a competitor, that's a shorter answer. As a competitor to Ethereum.
You could do folding at home or setting at home. It's like you load a web page and all of a sudden you're crashing
GPU with it, right?
Yep, right, yeah, WebGL. Especially when we get compute shaders and all that good stuff.
Any other ideas? We're out of questions. Or we have a follow-up on that? Or?
No, that's my last
one. Anyone else have any thoughts? All right, so we are going to be...
Yeah, I do, actually. There must be one... There must be at least some JavaScript that benefits from ahead-of-time compiling. Why not?
Well, I mean, asm.js benefits from ahead-of-time compiling.
But not what I meant. The point is if... you said... Oh, we don't want, it doesn't speed up JavaScript to compile it to WASM, but it must speed up some JavaScript to compile it to WASM, if it's not very dynamic.
You're right, I can postulate workloads where even if we implemented a JavaScript VM in WebAssembly, it could go faster, but I wouldn't imagine that would be the normal case.
No, you wouldn't do it as a VM. You would take JavaScript and compile it to machine code, like, you know, the way GCJ compiles Java to machine code. Why not? It's a language. You can compile it.
Oh, that is, you're absolutely true in the general case. We've considered caching for non-asm.js JavaScript for quite a while. The hard thing is it's to do the good job, you really need to ambiently specialize the JavaScript to the dynamic environment. So if you cache that code, you need to remember all the places you need to patch, all the assumptions you made. Basically, except asm.js, where we've really distilled out the whole environment, with general asm.js or JavaScript compilation, it's like a big graph of constraints and assumptions and ambient, like everything. So it's a lot harder problem to compile. Now,
we have an
the parsing overhead. Well, on that particular subject, let's say there's a lot of variants of caching.
I'm so sorry. Oh, sure. Why don't we take this up to the once we get all the announcements done? We have one announcement here, and then
announcement. I'm Chris, co-founder of the Things Network New York. We're building a free, open source, and distributed data network for the Internet of Things here in the five boroughs. We're looking for people with Linux experience, PR experience, and anyone who's interested making this a reality. You can go to thethings.nyc or find me after. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Chris. And I'll just say we're going to be heading off for a drink to Jake's Saloon, 206 West 23rd Street. That's just across 7th Avenue on the downtown side. And we'll be going in groups right after this. So if you just want to hang out, you can come with us. All right, thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Luke.